Okay, what's happened? I took it off. Ah, I pulled out the plug, that's why. Okay, well, thanks for coming out this morning. I'll start out by just giving a little bit of background so you can kind of understand where I'm coming from with this stuff. So I've been working across systems administration and software development roles for probably 20 years or more now. I've always tried to kind of script and automate things just as a natural course of way of working. So I started out, I was running a bulletin board, so I used batch scripts with DOS and desk view. I moved on to shell scripts and Perl and that kind of stuff with Unix, with Solaris, or it was SunOS, and then retroactively became Solaris 1 or some weird thing like that. Anybody remember when that happened? A few old folks in here, good. So then I moved on to, I discovered a tool called FAI install. How many people know that one? Yeah, a few. I would figure here, if anywhere, any conference, people are going to know what that is. So that's a precursor to Foreman, and it was to automatically install Debian onto physical servers with Pixie Boot and that kind of stuff. And that was really cool, and I hooked that up to CF Engine, which I know people here know about, to configure to install things like Apache and Netscape Server, which was server-side JavaScript before it was cool, way before it was cool. Then I moved on to discovered VMware, started doing virtualization and Puppet, and then moved on to Chef and EC2 and those sorts of things. So I've been doing this all along, and I'm not one of these people who like kind of pioneered this stuff. I was always kind of learning from other people and reading what other people were doing. I always found it really cool. And then around the time when DevOps became a thing, and I guess it was here in Ghent that the first DevOps Day conference took place a few years back. Around the time when that became a thing, and a couple of guys who worked at ThoughtWorks wrote the Continuous Delivery book, and I read an early access version of that book, I thought it was really cool, and I went to work for ThoughtWorks. And so that's what I've been doing the past couple of years. And what I've been doing there is going in with software development teams into kind of different client organizations and different industries, trying to help them do continuous delivery and more recently microservices. And my kind of role in all that was to work with the ops folks, infrastructure folks, to figure out what can we do to get that path to production working really well. And the thing that I found was that in different organizations, in most organizations, people were using the tools. They were using virtualization and then later cloud. They were using the server configuration tools and all these automation things, but they weren't really using them right, or they weren't using them the ways that it seemed to me could were really helpful or could be the most effective. And I kept waiting for one of these people who had kind of pioneered the infrastructure as code stuff and DevOps to come up with a book that I could give to these people. And none of them did, so finally I just gave it a go and wrote a book myself. And now I get to come and talk at conferences, which is cool. But the angle that I'm coming at with this is that of going into organizations who are trying to kind of scale up, maybe, or who are large organizations trying to figure out how to adopt these practices and to think about how to use the tools, more effective ways of using the tools. So organizations that are doing this stuff, what they're really after is speed, right? It's that whole time to market. We want to come up with a hypothesis, a new product idea or feature idea. We want it to do a minimum viable product and get it in front of customers quickly, get feedback on how they use it, and do continuously improvement. So it's all about kind of doing stuff quickly, getting stuff to production quickly. And often the infrastructure and the operations part of the organization is seen as an obstacle to this, right? Because they're kind of a break, and they take too long to get environments and provision servers and those kind of stuff. But the reality is that there really are risks, right? So there's good reasons why people don't necessarily move all that fast with these things, or more to the point, there's things that we're trying to achieve that are important. So although in the agile and kind of DevOps world, we often get frustrated with people who are responsible for governance and security and compliance and those kind of things, and kind of think that they don't get it and they're behind the times. That there really are things that we need to take account of. Even if you're not dealing with people's money, even if we're not handling people's credit card details, we do have a responsibility with the user's data to protect that and behave responsibly with that, handle it responsibly. And we don't want to be the organization that leaks out millions of users' passwords and gets in the news for that, right? We want to be doing the right thing. And we also just want to keep things up. So, for example, I'll give a bit of advice. If you're going into a bank and you're telling them how they ought to do this automation stuff and how they, you know, how they should be doing things. Explaining to them that they should do it because this is how Netflix do it doesn't really wash very well, right? Because they're like, well, Netflix, it's just, you know, just movies, right? We're doing serious stuff. But, you know, as a Netflix user, you know, I wanted to see when Luke Cage came out, I wanted to see it on that Saturday night. I made the time to see it and I sat down and they had an outage and I couldn't watch it that night. And that's disappointing, right? And so, you know, our users want our stuff to be up and we need our stuff to be working properly. So, but there is kind of a myth out there that we have to choose between speed and doing things responsibly and doing things you know, the right way. And fortunately, we've got you know, we've now got evidence that actually that's bullshit, right? The whole you know, you either go fast, you do it right. How many folks are familiar with the State of the DevOps report? I'm hoping plenty of people here are. Yeah, this is a great reference if you're talking to management or whatever to provide those kind of you know, research-backed numbers. And if you're not aware that they're doing the this year's survey is out, and you know, as many people as possible should fill that out, and as much data as you know, as we get and share about this stuff, the better it is for all of us. So please have a look at that. But the goal here is to think about how can we make changes rapidly and frequently while still being responsible, still thinking about operational quality. Because as it turns out, as the State of the DevOps report shows, that speed is quality, right? You need to be able to move quickly and make improvements with a very short turnaround if you're going to have quality. And if you go into organizations which pride themselves on heavyweight processes and they say we have to have these slow processes and take our time and have lots of people involved and lots of bureaucracy around our decision-making process because we're taking this seriously, and you go and look at their infrastructure, it sucks, right? Most of these places are just terrible in how kind of you know, inconsistent their infrastructure are and the kind of gaping security problems and issues they have because it takes them so long. So we need to leverage speed in order to get operational quality. So how do we do that? And infrastructure as code, right? That's the title of the talk, so obviously it's the solution to all the problems I'm going to mention in the talk, right? So I define it like this. Basically, I'm taking tools and practices from software engineering and applying it to managing our infrastructure. And particularly, I tend to focus on the agile engineering practices, things like test-driven development and continuous integration and continuous delivery and those sorts of things. And so the basic 101 thing for infrastructure as code is you're defining your systems in code and, you know, Puppet manifests, Packer files, Docker files, whatever it may be. You're putting things into code that you can check into version control. The basic thing that you need to have in place is, so I talk about dynamic infrastructure platforms. This is how do those tools get access to compute and networking and storage. And it's important to note that it's not you know, I try not to just say cloud because it's not just cloud, right? As I, you know, referred to before, you can do this stuff with tools like Foreman to do it. To, you know, you have a pool of hardware that you can dynamically provision. You can do it with virtualization, even if they're not the kind of cloud IaaS type products. You can still manage to create the kind of framework that you need. The most important things are that it needs to be programmable and it needs to be on demand. So essentially, you need to have an API that you can point your Terraform or whatever at, and that it will immediately provision your resources when you need them. That's the kind of bottom line. If you don't have that, you really can't do this stuff. So, okay. Now we've got cloud, we've got automation. People can come to us and say, I need a server, and they can, you know, we can give it to them quickly, or they can provision it themselves with a script. Isn't that great? They can guess what comes next, aside from the lawsuit from Disney. And it's things running out of control, right? It's server sprawl. So now we've got loads and loads of servers everywhere. They're all inconsistent. Gareth is getting angry because we don't know how many different versions of OpenSSL we've got on different machines. And this is very difficult to manage, right? Configuration drift. Configuration drift is basically that, you know, we can create servers and they're all the same when they start out, or when we create each new one. But over time, they start to become different as people make changes to them based on different needs or solving different problems. If we're not able to keep the configuration management on top of these things, they drift apart. And we get, basically we start being afraid to use the tools kind of wholeheartedly. So how many folks here are using tools like Chef, Puppet, Ansible, and so on regularly? Yeah, I mean, pretty much everybody here wouldn't be here, right? How many people are having those tools run automatically in the background on a cycle, on a schedule? So a fair number, but not fully, right? And this is, I think this is kind of a bit more of a, you know, leading edge in the industry. quite a lot of people are still using it a little bit more interactively. So they're saying, I'm going to take my tool. I've got Java installed on my machines. I have some machines that need to have the newer version of Java, so I'm going to edit and run it against those machines. Then I need to make another change to another set of machines. And then if you try to run, let this thing run by itself or run across everything, it's going to break because of those inconsistencies you've created. So there's also this idea of automation lag, and this is applies not just to infrastructure configuration, but also to automated tests and deployment and things like that. And that's the idea that the longer it's been between running the automation process in a given context, like in a production environment, for example, the longer it's been, the more work you're going to have to do to get it back into shape where it will actually run successfully. And so this is why when you have teams who are responsible for automated testing and they have their automated test suite that they maintain, and they run that like every few weeks or whenever there's a release or whatever it is, that often takes them quite a lot of work to update it because people have been developing stuff and now they have to change all the tests to get them to run again and pass and to adapt to the new features or whatever. And that really kind of kills the value of it, and it's why a lot of projects to automate things fail, because they haven't found ways to make that automation run as a continuous thing. If you look at it this way, we need to apply small changes frequently rather than trying to do big things. So rather than trying to do the top thing of going from A to B in one big set of work, we need to do each piece. Do it a little bit at a time. Each thing you make sure that it's a discrete bit of work that's measurable and you can write tests around it. And if you do that, it becomes small. If you do it in small bits, it's easy to do, and you can accumulate up to where you get to the state that you want to be. So then continuously synchronizing. So this is that thing of having the agent run continuously to reapply changes. And this, again, it cuts down that lag. Even if you're not making a new change, it just ensures that your automation is still working, is still relevant. And if anything comes up, if anything breaks, you want to find out right away and address it and fix the automation. If you do need some variation between machines, different versions of Ruby, say, on different machines, you encode that into the automation to find different classes of machines that the automation can run against so that it is all captured there and doesn't give you any reason to go outside of the configuration management. And then the other approach to this, the alternative to that continuous synchronization, is more of the kind of Phoenix or immutable infrastructure approach, to say that what we're actually going to do is make sure that none of our servers live for very long. Every couple of days, we're going to tear them down and bring up new ones. Or that actually, with the immutable infrastructure, the idea is that this becomes our mechanism for making a configuration change. So we don't make a configuration change on a running machine. Instead, we build a new machine with the change on it. And then we can test it, and we can swap it in for the existing machine. And this gives us that ability to kind of test and make sure that we've got consistency. We know what we've tested is as close as possible to the thing we actually put into production. So I'll tell a story. I was working on a project where we were using Chef to build all of our servers. And we didn't have, our team didn't have any control over dynamic DNS, so we couldn't kind of make DNS changes. So I figured it'd be a clever idea to make a Chef recipe that automatically built the etc hosts file and put in so that any given environment, for example, an application can just connect to the hostname DB, and the host file would have mapped that to the right IP address for that environment. And that means we had a lot, simplified our configuration for our applications, which was really cool. Until I went and made a mistake in the Chef cookbook and pushed it up, and it mangled etc hosts on all of our machines. And now they couldn't reach anything. And in fact, even though I went and quickly fixed the mistake and pushed it up to the Chef server, none of the machines could actually connect to the Chef server to get the updated recipe. So that was a lot of work to fix. That was painful. So it was just a reminder that although this automation is awesome in allowing us to make changes and improvements across infrastructure very rapidly, you can also do a lot of damage across your infrastructure very rapidly. Someone had a talk yesterday, I can't remember the name of the guy, it was from Weaveworks, and he had this, they had like a chalkboard with the number 57 days since we completely destroyed production. And I thought that was cool, that's the world we're living in. So there are things we can do to kind of reduce those. Things are going to happen, but and obviously we want to make sure that we can rebuild things very quickly and easily when it does happen. But we also would like to do kind of automated testing and things to kind of try to catch those mistakes before they hit, even non-production environments. So that the incident that happened to me in the host file mostly affected our test and development environments, but it was still painful because a lot of people then couldn't do their work. So it's important, you know, I learned the importance of having tests that go in before I inflict them on developers, for instance. And so this is just basic CI, right? The idea is that, you know, write automated tests for your infrastructure and have them triggered on every commit, and you're committing frequently, so you're getting that fast feedback and continuous feedback of whether your infrastructure still hangs together and does what it should do. How many people use kind of this kind of test-driven development, continuous integration on their infrastructure? How many people here do that? It's fairly low, good number, but still fairly low. And it is one of those things I think we talk about a lot, and it's a bit difficult to do and difficult to kind of build up those habits. So I think we've got a ways to go as an industry. But this leads then, if we're talking about continuous integration, this continuous delivery where we're able to kind of push changes through environments and just make sure that we've kind of tested it. Each, whatever kinds of testing activities need to happen can happen before we push it out to production. I'll talk a little bit more around some of those patterns in a moment. But if we think about how to kind of organize code, this is another thing that comes up, especially as code bases grow and start becoming less trivial. And that's because it starts becoming more messy. Now, the kind of basic first approach that many, certainly that I took, that many other people take, is if you have something like Terraform, you have a single file, or maybe a single project that defines, and you've got kind of your, all your environments are in that, right? And Charity Majors wrote a post on her blog a couple of months ago where she talked about, you know, the lessons she learned from doing this and the kind of the pain points and how she, you know, the ideas of what she did to kind of move past that. And it's a really good read. But, you know, basically what it comes down to is, you know, obviously if you're messing around in your staging environment and you make lots of changes to it, it's very easy to accidentally, you know, cause problems for your production. And it's not just a problem with Terraform. So people, you know, Terraform has this kind of state file which sometimes can cause issues where it gets corrupted and then it affects everything in it. So that's a good reason to kind of, you know, break things down beyond that. But the same thing can happen with CloudFormation or anything else where it's a single project where you run the command and it kind of affects the whole thing. And it's not about organizing your code, so you can organize your code into different files and modules and all that stuff would be very nice. But if the point is you run the command on that set of files and it works on them as a unit, that's where you've got your kind of your blast radius, your kind of danger. So we want to design things so and structure it so we're minimizing risk for making changes, because remember, we want to make frequent changes, small changes. So if we think about how do we split up our infrastructure in a way to make that safe. And so the next step that many people move on to is having, it's splitting up into separate projects in essence. So you've got your project with your staging environment, you can do whatever you want to it. Production is a different thing, a different project, so you know you won't break it. And then once you're happy with whatever changes you're working on, you can copy them into your production. Now, I'm a little uncomfortable with this. I think it works okay for fairly simple and you know infrastructures, and you have a small number of people working on it, and you can kind of keep good discipline around it. But the problem is you do end up getting drift, right? You're relying on people to copy changes across. People will jump on and start making changes to production code directly because they're wanting to fix a problem that's there, or they're working on something that manifests there, and they don't necessarily copy it back into the staging, for instance. And that's manageable. You can always copy your production, your current production project onto your staging and kind of get it back into sync. But it just relies a little bit too much on manual stuff, particularly as teams grow for me. So the approach I like to take is more of a continuous delivery approach, and it's the idea of let's make a template project that defines what our environment should look like. And essentially you version it and you pass it between environments. Right, so you probably use a tool, either a continuous integration server tool like Jenkins or Team City or something like that, or you might use you know, GoCD, which is a more continuous delivery pipeline focused tool for managing these things. And the idea is just that if you have variations between environments, you put those as parameters so that your definition of your environment, your set of Terraform files and whatever else go along with that, or CloudFormation, whatever tools you're using, whatever they are, you can have this kind of version thing, which you don't change as you take it. You run it in one environment, you test things, and then you copy it and apply it to the next environment. And if at any of those kind of stages it fails, you find a problem, you go back and fix it in the code and push it through all those environments again to make sure you're still running all of your tests and you have high confidence in the changes that you're making. Now, here's the problem that comes up with this, is that it can be slow, right? Because it's, especially when you're, as your infrastructure grows and you've got a lot of things in that, you know, in a given environment, spinning it up to run tests against it and running the tests against it can take a really long time. And so this is where we get into how do we modularize and break apart our infrastructure. And again, it's just like with software development. It's, as you get a big code base, you want to modularize. And so, for instance, we can make you know, cookbooks or playbooks or whatever you have for the more kind of lower level things with more focused things that you can run tests on that run very quickly. And then you combine those together, assuming those pass, you combine it together with the other bits to do like test, okay, so what does a server look like? Does that work correctly? And only then you kind of push it along to, okay, let's spin up the set of infrastructure with the, you know, the networking and all those and make sure those things hang together. And there's a real kind of art and a lot of, I guess, practice that goes into making this efficient, because you really want to make sure you're balancing like the speed and the risk here, because you can spend a lot of time writing unit tests at the low level that actually don't have a lot of value. So if you've got, you know, a playbook which installs, you know, a JDK, it's like a one-line thing that's just doing a package command. You don't really probably need a unit test for that. It's more where you've got you're doing something a little bit more complicated, and you've got a higher risk that you're afraid it might go wrong. You might, you know, you want to catch that. But as a general rule, you're trying to push things to the left. You're trying to make sure that you know, you're catching things at the earliest point that you can, because that's where things run faster and you get the feedback faster, so that you can try to keep the tests and the activities that happen over on the right, where it spins everything up. You want to keep that as lightweight as possible and not spend too much time on that. And so you can structure your pipelines to mirror this. You're essentially kind of aggregating cumulatively different components, having pipelines for each component that run tests on that. And if they pass, they push it into the next level of the pipeline, which pulls things together, integrates things, and moves on. And if you do this, you have good discipline around it, you know, it can really help to kind of making the whole thing run fast so that it shouldn't take too long to go from somebody committing a change to getting the feedback that, yeah, it all hangs together and passes its tests. And so it goes a bit deeper into how do we design our infrastructure to enable change and to cope as we grow, as you know, our requirements grow, as our teams get bigger, and also just to avoid, if we do this right, we can avoid the need to kind of do that big design of saying we're going to design the end state infrastructure with all the bells and whistles we think we might need. And instead you can say, let's build the thing for what we need right now, what we've built so far. And allow it to grow and evolve as we learn what we actually need, that kind of evolutionary architecture approach. So again, change. To me, change is the main criteria to use. What are the things that tend to change together? Because you want to structure things so that for the typical change, for your most frequent changes, you're not having to go across teams. You're not having to you know, do handovers or cross boundaries or do the planning and the coordination, because that adds so much overhead. When you've got to get a bunch of people together to talk about changes. So for instance, you might have you know, some cloud formation templates that configure up your networking. You got different teams using that networking. So if they, you know, every time anybody needs to make a change, they've got to change that same file, and it becomes a point of conflict, you know, between the teams that, you know, you're worried about stepping on each other's toes. So think about how to divide up your infrastructure in a way that keeps it more loosely coupled. And that goes to the thing of aligning it to organizational structure and how your teams are structured. Conway's Law, how many people are familiar with Conway's Law? Okay, so a fair number of people. If you're not aware of it, go and look at any talk or article on microservices, and it's in there, right? They all talk about Conway's Law, which is basically just saying that an organization structure produces software that looks like its organization structure, right? So if you've got database teams and, you know, web server teams and networking teams, your infrastructure or your system will be designed to match that. So you need to think about how to realign. How to realign it, and it might mean changes to the team structure, to the architecture structure, whatever it is, just make sure that they line up. Otherwise, you're just going to have conflict and friction. So if you think about where do we split, all right, so we have one environment that we want to split into multiple pieces to make it more manageable. Again, the kind of obvious and kind of naive approach is to say, let's split it up into, like, say, front end and, you know, application tier and database tier, because that's the natural way that we draw boundaries in our infrastructure, particularly from a security point of view, but that's then kind of bled into all of our other kind of architectural decisions. But then when you get down to reality, most of the times we want to make a change, changes tend to cross over those boundaries. And so what we end up doing is having, again, we've got to have coordination activity and put together project plans and documents to manage how are we going to change these different elements of the system. And then we also find then that we have to worry about coordinating these files. So what happens if the change for the for the application tier goes through before the changes for the other ones? Is that going to break things? And so it just adds overhead that we don't need. So it makes more sense to think about splitting up your infrastructure into files based on, again, those boundaries, those things that typically change together, and ideally things that typically teams are responsible for, so that those team can do the things that it needs to do without having to minimize how much it has to coordinate with other teams and worry about impacting what other teams are doing. So the last kind of topic I'll touch on today is around cycle time. And this, I'm often asked how to measure, how do we know, are we doing this well or getting the benefit out of it? And those tensions that, that we talk about around structuring our infrastructure and our teams and all this, I think that the acid proof, the acid test for this comes out in how long does it take to get typical changes done? And it's important to look at this in terms of the elapsed time from somebody having a need and then actually having that need satisfied. So I talked to someone a little while ago at an organization where they had they'd implemented OpenStack, and they were very proud. It takes us, we can provision a server in like 10 minutes. This is really awesome. We're really kind of optimizing stuff. I was like, that's great. So what can my developers use so they can get access and they can create themselves some servers? They can make servers for themselves in 10 minutes, right? Well, no, actually, they need to raise a ticket, and then we'll create the server for them. It takes us 10 minutes to create the server, but we have like an SLA of like one day for us to actually run it for you and give you a server. So, okay, so we've got to wait a day. That's not great, but for a big organization, that's still actually kind of impressive. So after a day, we get our server, and we can start deploying our software. Well, no, actually, you get the server, but you won't be able to log into it. After you have the server, then you can raise tickets. You can raise a ticket to get a user account created on the server that you can use to log in. And then you also need to raise tickets to get Java installed and the application server installed. Oh yeah, you'll need networking as well. You need like the routes and stuff set up so that you can access, that kind of stuff and firewall rules and everything else. So it actually ends up being more like a week or so before you can actually get the server in your hands. So it's important to think of these things in that context of, who wants something and when can they actually start using it. And you can use this for different activities. So in software development, particularly in continuous delivery, we often talk about committing a line of code and getting into production, and that's great. But when we're talking about operations and infrastructure, it's useful to think about the different kind of services and the different activities. So I like to think about things like how long does it take us to rebuild something? You can apply it to different things. So an existing environment, how long would it take us to rebuild it? How about just a server? How about if somebody gets a hold of our AWS credentials and trashes everything, how long will it take us to create a new AWS account or whatever it is and use our code to rebuild and be back up and running? And can we? Hopefully we can, right? How long does it take to create a new environment? And again, this is from somebody saying, we need an environment to test something. So a new environment for an existing application or system. We've added a couple of testers onto the team and they're clashing because they only got one environment. Can we get a new one? How long does it take before those testers can start using the new environment? What if the new environment, what if it's for a new application? What if it's for a new application stack? What if we're a Java shop and we've got a team that now wants to start running Node? How long will it take us to get an environment into their hands? The reason I'm emphasizing this so much is because it crosses all of those things. It crosses your process, and all the kind of the things that are involved in doing things. And these are what drive the improvements, the ways of, so that we're not just kind of buying products or downloading products and installing, nifty tools, but not actually giving real kind of benefit in ways that are really meaningful. So finally, there's just some other books in the past kind of year or so in particular. There have been a fair number of interesting books that have come out in this space, as well as some classics that I put up here. I'll publish these slides so that you can look at those at your leisure. But that's pretty much me done. So thanks for coming out. guess we've got time for some questions. So the question was, how do I suggest splitting up modules at what level of granularity? And I think it's the classic consultant answer, it depends. I think for like a new project, I tend to default to not splitting it up too much, start out at kind of a fairly high level, and then as you go along, you start seeing where the right boundaries are. I would look at kind of team structures and what's within a team scope. So if you can divide it up so that at least each team has its own, maybe its own repository and things within it. It's really is, I think, by analyzing the change, what kind of things tend to change together, that makes the most sense to me. Does that help a little bit? I mean, it's not a very concrete answer, but.
Yeah, somewhat.
Yeah. Okay, somewhat. So how do we make this mesh with the fact that things are going to break, right? And there are going to be things that you don't detect, and there's going to be things that you only find out because your customers find out about it. So it's to me, it's kind of layers, kind of an onion. Or actually, I've got a colleague, a tester named Abby Bangzer, who talks about the Swiss cheese. And so if you look at a block of Swiss cheese, you look at you slice up your Swiss cheese and you've got holes in it, but the block as a whole, you don't have any holes going through it. And so testing and monitoring, to me, are kind of like different layers. You're trying to put things in which catch the things early as much as possible, and then you've got another layer of, say, integration tests, which catch the things which you can't catch at that level. And then you end up with kind of monitoring, which is like looking at production and hopefully, trying to catch the things that you didn't predict, but that at least you have some way of trying to notice. So things will slip through, but it's just about putting in sensible, mechanisms to try to catch things along, beforehand as much as possible, and as much as pragmatic, right? Because it is. You can go overboard and kind of end up with really difficult to maintain, test suites and all of that. So you have to be kind of pragmatic about risk versus reward on that.
Any ideas on the use of code review tools, for example, Garrett?
So code review tools, I haven't used them a lot. Most of the people I work with tend to use pair programming, so you're kind of doing continuous code review in essence. There are environments where you need to have more kind of control, and particularly like trails, record trails around things. You can certainly use tools like Garrett or things like that for your infrastructure code if that's how your process is. I tend to favor, so when it comes, I actually had a slide I took out because I thought I was going to overrun, which was on governance and compliance and how you use the pipeline for that. And it's just the idea that your people who are doing reviews and audits and things like that, ideally what you want them to do is to focus on the pipeline and what checks do you put into the pipeline, automated checks to catch things, and then having logs that you can review, audit trails and so on, so you can make sure that things are correct, rather than having to inspect every single change that goes through. So it's more about the system and the kind of checks behind. But I'm a big fan of the thing about code reviews is making sure, again, you're closing that feedback loop, right? So the sooner the someone is in time to a change or somebody looking at it, the better the feedback is, which is why I find pair programming quite effective for that. Other questions? Otherwise, I guess we can, oh, wait, sorry.
So can you tell us something about how you foster these kind of mindsets in those big companies that you...
How do we foster these mindsets in the big companies? It is, and I think maybe you can tell from some of the kind of the ways I talk, a lot of it is about appealing to the kind of management level and product level commercial folks as to what benefits they get from it. And then on the technical side, the engineering side, and again, it's about looking at problems. What problems do people have? What pain are people feeling? And how can this stuff help? And oftentimes you find that actually when people are like, people bring us in to help with things, and we find that actually this isn't necessarily the answer, right? There's more to it. So it's important that you're focusing on what problems people really have and feel and think about how this can help with that. Some more kind of specific things, I guess. So the whole Spotify organizational model, are people familiar with that? I'm curious. That's become really popular, certainly in the UK and the US. Whole thing of tribes and chapters and guilds and things like that has become really popular. And I think there's some valuable stuff in there in terms of organizing groups that get together frequently that cross over your teams, whatever your team structure is, to talk about topics. So like infrastructure, so setting up an infrastructure. At a current client, we're setting up an infrastructure guild, chapter we're calling it. The terminology is a bit much. And especially we're getting people like across the architects, across the different development teams, across the operations teams to get together regularly and talk about these topics and talk about problems and how to solve them. So it's just getting people together to talk about stuff, I guess, is the bottom line. Question?
Yeah, you have this automated pipeline, and at some stage you detect something as an error. I find it very hard to figure out a way to back out that change, because if you find out there's a bug in staging, you wouldn't want to push that through to the production. But what's a good way to work around it?
So the question is, if you've got a pipeline, automated pipeline, and you have a failure in a state, and you know, say a staging environment, it can be difficult to kind of back it out, and you don't want to move it on, obviously, to production if you found a problem. I mean, obviously, you know, with tools, some people focus on having rollback scripts, but then I think what most people do, or quite a lot of people do, is focus more on roll forward. So it's how do you just take, so you go and you make the fix. So you might go into the environment and figure out what the problem is and how to fix it. Maybe you add a test to catch it in an earlier environment, but then you change the code. You push it through and essentially do a new build. And this is where that immutable pattern often comes in handy, where it's like rather than trying to kind of untangle something that went wrong on a machine, you just build a new machine with the new version of the code with the fix on it. You make sure it's okay, and then you can throw away the old one. Okay. All right. Thanks.